Good morning.
Morning.
Oh, we can do better than that. How's everyone doing? Good. I know it's a long weekend. We're probably a little sleepy, need some coffee. I know I am. I don't drink coffee though. So.
I was going to say, I wonder what John would be like on coffee.
I don't even want to get started on that. I drink tea. That's about it. Welcome to Corinth Community Church. We're really excited that you're with us. Why don't you stand? And we're going to get started with some worship this morning.
Depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors afar to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. And all powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laid in the snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, unsavable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Incomparable.
Incomparable, unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart. You love me the same. You are amazing, God.
You see.
You see the depths of my heart, and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You see the depths of my heart, and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won, He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. There's no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won, as He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. There's no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I hear the cry of every longing heart, worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb.
I will rise,
and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise and rise. Splendor of a King. All the earth rejoice. All the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light. In darkness tries to hide. And trembles at his voice. Trembles at his voice. And I pray, he's our God. Sing with me, how great he's our God. And all will see how great, how great he's our God. It's rich. To age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead, three in one, Father, Spirit, Son.
Name above.
Name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God.
Name above all names.
The name above all names. You are worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing how great is our God.
How great
is our
He's our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much that we can come into your presence, God, where we're gathered, you're here with us. So Father, I pray that you would just be with us today as we're here to meet with you, God. I pray that you would just help us to leave our burdens of the week with you, God. I pray that you would help us to come into your presence, God, and take everything that you have for us today, and to help us to just accept it and to just open our hearts to receive it, God. I pray that you would just be with us today. Amen.
How's everybody doing? Yeah, it's good to see you on this long weekend. Thanks for coming. We got a couple exciting things coming up. One is on June 11th. It's Ice Cream Sunday. This and Chocolate Sunday are my favorite of the year. What we're going to do is the church will supply all the ice cream and the bowls and that kind of stuff. But if you want to sign up to bring a topping, you're welcome to do so. So we're going to send that around. By the way, you may be seated. Also, this is last Sunday. If you want to take a jar, thank you. They're starting to come in. If you want to fill it with change or a check or something for the pregnancy, I always get the name wrong, babe. Pregnancy support. Peterborough Pregnancy Support Services. Yeah. Okay. Those guys. They provide young mothers who maybe are pregnant and are struggling and they need things. A lot of them, most of them, in poverty. And that's a great service they provide in the downtown. So if you want to give something towards that, we just ask you to bring it back on Father's Day. In front of you on your tables, you've got the baskets. If you choose to give anything or if you want to fill in, you'd like to be on our mail list and receive updates on Kawartha Community Church. We are brand new in every way. We've relaunched since COVID and we're growing each week and we've got new families joining us and we're really a part of something as a church. We're very alive right now and if you want to be a part of building something significant, this is a great opportunity for you here. And we love our location. God has given it to us and we've just got a great relationship with the school and we do a lot of things for students locally, including the food bank. So if each week when you're shopping, if you want to pick up a couple of non-perishable food items, they're over there. We've actually got a list of suggestions. If you're out looking for something and you don't know what to get the students, that's a great opportunity. Also, in lieu of rent, we actually support financially the food bank. And so we support the food bank. Many students benefit, especially in these days of inflation and high rent costs. And we in exchange get this room and the big room outside to use as a church. And so it's a great, I don't want to say codependent, but a great collaboration for us to have as a church. Also, like I said, if you choose to give anything, we accept credit and debit over there. There'll be somebody on the break and immediately after the service if you choose to give that way. Thank you. We're working towards, like I said, building something, and KCC is a great investment. All right. Why don't you take 10 minutes, grab a coffee, and take a little break, and then when we come back, we'll focus on the teaching.
Rabbi, you couldn't wait, could you?
We're sorry, we just wanted to clear a few things up, if that's okay.
By all means.
You Jewish boys are far from home.
Yes, as a matter of fact, we are. Shalom to you too.
Here's our traditional Jewish greeting for you.
Don't lift a finger.
That was a warning.
Try it again and see what happens.
Quiet, Big James.
Shalom to you too. Oh, you filthy dogs!
I said quiet.
Let us do something.
And what would that achieve?
Defending your honor.
They reviled and humiliated you.
They deserve to have bolts of lightning rain down and incinerate them.
Yes, fire from the heavens.
Fire?
You said we could do things like that. Say the word and it will happen.
Why not? We knew we couldn't trust these people. We shouldn't have come here in the first place. They don't deserve you.
Why do you think I had you work Melek's field? What was I trying to teach you?
To help?
You think it was just to be more helpful? Or to be better farmers?
It was to show you that what we're doing here will last for generations. What I told Fotina at the well, and what she then told so many others, it's sowing seeds that will have a lasting impact for lifetimes. Can you not see what's happening here? These people that you hate so much are believing in me without even seeing miracles. It's the message, the truth that we're giving them. And you're going to get in the way of that because a few people from a region you don't like were mean to you. That they're not worthy? What, you're so much better? You're more worthy? Well, let me tell you something. You're not. That's the whole point. It's why I'm here.
I'm sorry.
Sorry, Rabbi. As we gather others, I need you to help show the way. To be humble.
We will.
You wanted to use the power of God to bring down fire to burn these people up?
Well, it sounds a lot worse when you say it that way.
You too. You're like a storm on the sea.
Come on.
Thunder exploding out of your chests at every turn. In fact, that's what I'm going to call you from now on. James and John, the sons of thunder.
Good morning. Earlier this year, I did a couple series, and then I really felt the Lord impress on me that if we were going to be fully devoted followers of Christ, we really needed to be able to connect with Christ. And so ever since then, we've been in the book of Luke, and we'll be there for a while. And what we're doing is we're relating what it was like to live with Jesus, who he was, what he said, what he did, so that you, throughout the week, can walk with Jesus. And you can know or approach a circumstance and know basically how he would view it or look at it. That's what a fully devoted follower of Christ does. A disciple tries to be like their teacher. And that is what God has called us to be, disciples. We're not Christians. Christians was a name the outsiders gave the church, Christ ones. And there's a, you know, some truth and utility to that, but at KCC, we're not interested in making cultural Christians. What we want you to be are disciples. And disciples are all in. And they live a much more dangerous, unpredictable path because they walk with Jesus. And when you walk with Jesus, the world looks differently. Everything tastes differently. It changes you on every level. And I know some of you probably are sitting there feeling a little guilty, thinking, I'm just me, and the me that is at my work or at my family or whatever doesn't seem very much like a Christ follower. I realize we're all works in progress, myself included. But there's progress. And you don't come about that progress by mistake. It's a very deliberate thing. It is cultivating a hunger in your hearts to know God and to learn about God and a fascination with this person, Jesus. One of the greatest gifts God ever gave me was as a 7 or 8 year old, opening my Bible, the book of Matthew, my Sunday school teacher had given me, and reading the words of Jesus and going, different than anything I've ever experienced, and a fascination with who he was. And I became a Christ follower. And that's what I want for you. I mean, there's the basic things that happen in a church, right? You get ministries, you volunteer, you do nice things, you smile at each other, all that kind of stuff. But in order for a church to be a church of Jesus Christ, it's a much deeper commitment. Those that sit about you are brothers and sisters in Christ and co-workers to accomplish what God wants us to do in this world. And I'm talking about a passage today. I'm fascinated by it because it's something Jesus did, and I've never heard a sermon on it. I'm going to preach two sermons on this passage. And it's fascinating to me because the people in it weren't the 12 disciples. Jesus had sent them out before and kind of sent them out to do what he did in some of the surrounding communities, and they did that, and I thought that would have been an amazing experience. He gave them authority to heal the sick and to share the message of God's hope, you know, and to drive out demons and to, like, just to occupy the way Jesus occupies when he comes into space. He changes everything, right? But then later on in Luke 10, he sends out 72 other people. And Luke's very deliberate. He says not the apostles, another 72 people. And that's a big number. Now, some scholars say 70, some say 72. There's a little discrepancy in the numbering there. But this is a large group of people. And he sends them out. So I'm going to read you through the first half of the passage, and I'm going to talk a little bit about it today. Because these are ordinary people. These are people that are just interested in Jesus. And he didn't pick these guys to be just apostles. They weren't supposed to be church leaders. They were just people that followed him. And he gives them power. It says Jesus gave them power and authority. We believe in a Trinity. We believe Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that Jesus is God himself. And later, he would send the disciples out with the power of the Holy Spirit. They would be the ones that do that. But Jesus also had authority and power himself, and he gives it to these 72 people, and he asks them to go ahead of him to communities he's going to go to. And listen to the passage, and then we'll talk a little bit about it. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others and sent them two by two ahead of him in every town and place where he was about to go. He told them, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. Go, I am sending you out like lambs among wolves. Do not take a purse or bag or sandals. Do not greet anyone on the road. When you enter a house, first say peace to this house. If someone who promotes peace is there, your peace will rest on them. If not, it will return to you. Stay there, eating and drinking, whatever they give you, for the worker deserves his wages. Do not move around from house to house. When you enter a town and are welcome, eat what is offered to you. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near you. But when you enter the town and are not welcomed, go into the streets and say, even the dust of your town we wipe from our feet as a warning to you. You be sure of this, the kingdom of God has come near. I tell you, it will be more bearable on that day for Sodom than for that town." Sodom was a place that fire had rained down and destroyed a community because of its decadence. "Woe to you, Chorazin. Woe to you, Bethsaida. For if the miracles that were performed in you had been performed in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago, sitting in sackcloth and ashes. But it would be more bearable for Tyre and Sidon at the judgment than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be lifted to the heavens? No, you will go down to Hades. Whoever listens to you, listens to me. Whoever rejects you, rejects me. But whoever rejects me, rejects him who sent me. So here you have Jesus. He's taking these ordinary people and he's sending them ahead of himself. He gives them this simple message and he gives them the authority to do a couple of things that are supernatural. Then he talks about the people that accept you and the people that don't accept you. And this seems like it would be fairly simple instructions, but I think it's good we pause here for a minute. Because in many ways, we are the 72. We're sent out into the world to prepare the way for Christ. That's about the size of our church right now. We're about 72 people. And Christ followers, although we have different gifts and we function in different ways, and we have some people that enjoy being in front of people, we have some people that enjoy being behind the scenes, we have some people that are very outspoken, others who are very quiet. We have people who are bold and people who are shy. We have people who are mechanical and other people are people persons. We have boys and girls, men and women. We have people of all different ages. We have generations, boomers, busters, millennials, Gen Z, and whatever else is coming down the pipe. We have all these different things. But we unify around one purpose. And that purpose is why we're here today. We're not here because everybody in the room is like you. In fact, there's a great diversity in our church. It's a wonderful thing. But diversity doesn't mean anything unless there's unity around a purpose and a person. And our unity is in Christ. And God challenges these people. He said, look out in the world. This is this harvest field. He uses farmer analogy because many of them would have farmed. And he says, there's this huge field and it's ripe. It's just ready to be harvested. But we have a problem. We don't have any workers, or we don't have enough workers. And he takes these 72 and he sends them out, and it seems like a large number. But the first prayer he gives them is, pray for workers to go into the harvest field. I've been a pastor for almost 30 years. And some people come to church because it's an experience for them. Some people come to church because they're looking for healing, which is good. You're at the right place. Some come to church because they want to learn morals. Excellent idea too, or to bring your children to learn morals. But it's so much more than that to be a Christ follower. Those things are good and functional and great. But what makes a church of Christ followers is this carrying of a burden. It's a burden that we all carry. It's something we're concerned about. And the burden that we all carry is to look out at our world. Look at our community. Look at where you work. Look at your extended family. And look at them and go, do they have Jesus? And what do they need? And where are they at? What's going on with their life? And probably most importantly, how does God see them? What does he see when he sees my wife or my kids or my coworkers or the people in my coffee shop or the postal worker or the grocery clerk? What does he see when he sees those people? Well, God sees them as this enormous harvest of people that are hurting, that are lacking, that are without hope. And he looks at them and he wants to bring the good news to them. The message that there is hope, there's redemption. That there is a God who cares about them. And the church that carries that burden and looks at that the way God does, looks at the school and goes, and I've repeated this and I will keep repeating it. We are not a church that meets at a school. We are here to bring Jesus Christ to every facet of this organization. We want to touch lives for teachers, students, administration, and we want to do the same in our community. God has placed us here for a reason. He has not placed us here because it's a great place to meet. He's placed us here with a mission. And as long as we have our eyes out there, we'll put up with all kinds of stuff, right? because we all share that burden. We'll put up with, you know, the room changes, or we'll put up with, okay, now we're doing this, or we'll put up with, you know, and like one of the most exciting things that happened this year was our pancake breakfast. I just watched you all just jump in, roll up your sleeves to serve pancakes to students. You know, and we had some show up. We had, I don't know, it was 15 or 17 of them show up. And we fed them pancakes and we shared the message and talked to them. And it was just encouraging to see you guys all jump in. Why? Because the harvest is plentiful. Our work will never be done here until we've reached the harvest field. And the commitment to bring Christ's message is a lifetime commitment. But Jesus says some things here that I think the church ignores sometimes, and Christ followers ignore, that have incredible relevance about the receptivity of who we're trying to reach. And Jesus, he seems to bring us back here a lot, and it's the way he lived himself that is both concerning and liberating. And it's talking about contingencies and repercussions. Contingencies and repercussions. He was sending these guys out. He wouldn't even let them wear sandals. They didn't bring all the stuff a traveler would bring. Normally a traveler comes to town, they have a big stick, a staff, and a bag over their shoulder, and an outer coat, and the sandals, and the money, and all those kind of things. You don't travel without those things. These guys would wander into town in shorts and a t-shirt. And they would bring the message of Jesus, and he said, find someone and tell them why you're there. And look to see if they're receptive to it. And if they are, bring God's peace. And he said, if they're not receptive, and this was kind of a Jewish thing that they did in those days, if a Pharisee was in a place that he considered unclean, when he left it, he would take his sandals off and shake them out for a couple of reasons. One is it was symbolic that he wanted nothing to do with that place. He was cutting ties with it. And two, it was a warning to the people that he left that there was something horribly wrong with where they were. It was unclean. And here Jesus tells these guys, I want you to do the same thing. If you go into a community and they're receptive, stay there. Eat, heal their sick, bring peace to them, and share the message of the kingdom of God. And don't jump all over the community. Stay in that one place and work with those people. But if they don't, go out on the street, shake off your feet or your sandals or whatever you're wearing, and say, the kingdom of God has been, you know, has come here, but you didn't do it. So we're moving on. And he talks about the consequences for those places. And that's concerning too. He's saying, look, if they're not going to accept this message and us, then that's a sad thing for them. There are consequences to ignoring the message of God's hope. We sometimes struggle with that as Christians because we want to be nice, don't we? We want to believe we can reach everybody. And a lot of times the preoccupation of Christians tend to be those hard-boiled eggs out there that have no interest in the message. And we'll see their rejection of us as, or the rejection of Jesus as a rejection of us, and we take it personally. And so we spend an enormous amount of our time and energy on those people that don't give Jesus the time of day. And we ignore people that are really open to God's peace and are hungry and are interested. Jesus once told his disciples, you know, when you do this, you're never going to get to the end of it. There are people out there that need and want Jesus, but there are people out there that don't. And you've got to be okay with the ones that do and the ones that don't. The ones that do, bring all that Jesus brings to them. And the ones that don't, it's okay. Shake your sandals off and move on. It's not about you. It's about Christ. I used to run a college and career group called Center Stage. It just was a blast. Like we had mostly Sir Sanford students. And I remember one group we reached. You know, it tended to be you reach one young adult, you reach a bunch, you know, because they were in herds. And we somehow had a real inroads into the girls' rugby team here at Sir Sanford. And so we had a whole row of these girls with big shoulders. You know, they were rugby players, kind of rough and tumble, and they'd come in with bruises, and, you know, it was pretty cool. And one guy became a Christian, so they started bringing all their friends, and they all became Christians. Anyways, one person they asked us to pray for was Steve. He was their coach. And Steve loved rugby, and I remember Steve came, and I just sensed he was really interested, really hungry. And so my wife and I really connected with him, and then I gave him a Bible. And he said, well, where do I start? And I said, well, you know, probably start in the New Testament, but you can start anywhere you want. Anyways, he called me on Tuesday. He was in Joshua. He had started in Genesis. This guy had read the first five books of the Old Testament in 2 days and was now reading Joshua. That sounds like a pretty hungry person to me. It sounds like somebody really open to the peace of Christ. And so the next Tuesday night, we took him out afterwards, and we spent hours talking to where Bellamy's, it was a restaurant, and sharing about Jesus and all those things. And he came to Jesus, and he came each week and baptized him. It's just awesome. Anyways, kind of lost touch with him. He moved away, and like he went back home after college, and, you know, I didn't really know much, you know, what was going on with him until he called me. He had moved to Newmarket, and he was in a church there. And he said, you know, I pulled some people together, you know, like young adults. And so here I'm kind of running the young adults group program. Can you come speak? And I was working full time in those days, so it was a big commitment. But I said, yeah, sure, I'll come. So, you know, after I got off work, Kristen and I, we traveled to Newmarket and went in this church. Anyways, I walk in this room, and it was center stage. It was round tables, it was cafe style, it was all the way, you know, I ran the ministry. This was the guy's introduction to me. First of all, there were way more people there than I thought there were. It's like 70 of them. And Steve's introduction is, remember that guy I told you about? That guy that, you know, thought up all this? This is him, listen to him. And I got up and I shared the message of Jesus. I mean, that's a harvest. That's a harvest. And those are the people, like many of you, who have a heart for Christ. Maybe you've lost the hunger. Maybe you've kind of lost your way a little bit. It's okay. You're a prayer away from coming back. And maybe when you think about bringing Jesus to your outside world, you think, me? Like I'm just such a mess up. Or I can't, you know, can't do that. I'm scared of people. I can't, scared of my own shadow. Like, if I speak about Jesus, it just sounds wrong coming out of my voice, you know? But the harvest is plentiful. There are all kinds of Steves out there. There's people like you and I. And God deemed it necessary to die on a cross, to reach you and I. And you have the fortunate gift of grace that God has bestowed upon you. Jesus looked at you and said, I want you. He saved you from your sins. He filled you with His Holy Spirit. And He picks you and He says, the workers, the harvest is plentiful, the workers are few. So what do I bring to my coworkers or my family or whatever? Well, three things, and he lists them right here. The first is the idea of peace, shalom. A Christ follower that is connected to Christ, who's reading their Bible and praying and are sensitive to the Holy Spirit, they bring something into social situations that impacts the entire setting. It's a calmness. It's something deeper and more meaningful and redemptive than all the na-na-na-na that people have. You know, right now, like, everybody talks about polarizing. how polarizing our culture is, right? They talk about politics, they talk about that. You know, one thing I know about Jesus, he didn't talk about politics much. He talked about the condition of the heart. And there are lots of people in our country, in our world, that have hearts, all of them. And some of them are on the left and the right, some of them are young and old, some of them are men and women. There's all kinds of them. And you got to look past that to look at the condition of their heart. What are they open to Jesus? And that's all that matters. And if they are open to Jesus, he wants to bring his peace to them. I've met many Christ followers who get caught up in the issues of the day. And I do too. I love culture. I love studying it. I actually sit down with a lot of pastors and teach them about culture. I think it is relevant. I mean, you know, if I was up here in a 1950s suit with a Brill Cream hair and everything like that, I'd be like I was an alien here, right? Culture matters. It really does. But culture is just culture. What's deep and meaningful, and the most important thing about me, is I have peace with God through Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, which means the animosity between God and I has been resolved, and I am now a child of God. Not only that, I have this brand new family of other followers of Jesus Christ, and we are brothers and sisters, and we look forward to eternity together, and we have hope, and we have love, and we are able to break the bondage of the sin that has been a part of our lives for generations. And when we walk into a situation, when we're connected with Christ, it's going to change. It really is. You know, you think, no, it doesn't. It sometimes comes slower than you think. And sometimes it's more subtle. But you bring peace if you bring Christ. Because Christ is the Prince of Peace. The more full of Jesus you are, the better you're going to be at drawing hungry people to yourself. And the second thing he says is healing. I'm really learning a lot this last 8 months about what happens when we're all in for Jesus. And I'm seeing him work in you guys. And I'm seeing some of you, you know, your tears come sometimes when you hear about God because you're really hungry for him. And some of you are curious, you know, and you're reading your Bibles and you're following along. And someone has told me this week, they're working through Luke with me and they're doing all those things. And some of you are learning about prayer or whatever. What's amazed me is how many miracles they've been. Now, we haven't had the kind of miracle where I get up in the front and part the room, you know, or we haven't called down lightning on anybody. You know, we haven't had any big signs in the heavens or anything like that. What we've had are 1,000 little miracles that each of you carry. And the thing about it is we need to start sharing them because some of you have a miracle that's happened to you. It's a, you know, a job that you weren't supposed to get, or it's you went for a diagnosis and it turns out it was way better, or, you know, there was someone that you've been separated from for a long time and God's brought you back together, or your love for Jesus is growing, and I'm seeing it in all your lives. There's nobody that's an exception. God is at work in all of you. Healing is happening to you. And part of being a Christ follower is carrying that healing to other people. To looking at someone's hurting and say, I will pray for you. To giving, you know, a coffee and attention and listening to people and caring about them. Asking people as you go through a line and check out how they really are. And smiling, you know, encouraging people. I remember when I worked here at the college, I was really worried about my witness, like, because I was young and stupid and gregarious, and, you know, sometimes I was a lousy witness, but I'll never forget one day I walked by and there were a couple coworkers and I said, hey, how's it going? And I used to go through the lobby about 60 miles an hour. I just walked fast and that. But I was just fading out of sight and one of them said to the other, there goes Scott Wheeler, the happiest man in the college. And I thought, I'll wear that. That sounds pretty good. I didn't know I was that happy. But apparently, Jesus in me was a contrast to what they were used to other people seeing. And they were drawn to that. Healing of relationships. A Christian who cannot resolve conflict is a contradiction in terms. Being a Christ follower is all based on the biggest unresolved conflict in history between God and man, and that gets resolved through Jesus. Christians don't carry around unresolved conflict. They don't bear grudges. They don't not forgive. I realize that forgiving is achingly hard. Some of you have gone through horrible things done to you by evil people. But the healing of your soul is to be able to let go and let God. It really is. It's being able to work through that hurt and that bitterness and allow God to heal you and open you up and make you vulnerable. Jesus brings healing. And then the kingdom of God, sharing the message of God's love. There's hope. You know, the Surgeon General last couple of weeks ago in the United States declared an emergency, a health emergency. You know what the health emergency was over? Loneliness. They've actually determined, and they've done multiple studies on this, that someone that's lonely dies sooner. They don't live as long. They're sick more. They're less successful. They make less money. They struggle in their relationships. And they struggle with their self-worth. This world has promised them so many things. And it's all coming home to roost. And we are seeing in our world. All of a sudden, a Christ follower and someone that's not a Christ follower is becoming nice and far apart. And I love it. I love it. I think this is so significant. If COVID did anything, is it separated those who are all in with Jesus from those that aren't. And folks, we're all in with Jesus here. That's who we are. That's where we're going. And when you do that, you bring the message of hope. Are you hurting? Jesus heals. By his stripes we're healed. Are you hopeless? Hey, I got a great future plan for you in Jesus Christ, and I got a great family you'll be a part of here. And for some of us, this is the only family we got right here. You lonely? God dwells within a follower of Jesus Christ. They're never alone. They have the Holy Spirit, and they can reach out to Jesus. And when you're connected to Jesus, it's just like, and you can connect with your Father in heaven through Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. And then you come week by week, and you learn more from each other, and you learn more about Jesus. This is what the world needs. The world doesn't need a different political party. It doesn't need more government programs. It doesn't need a new blockbuster movie, and it doesn't need the Toronto Maple Leafs to win the Stanley Cup. If you're hoping for that, that's going to take a long time. You know what it needs? It needs Jesus and his people who are committed in Christ. And so press on, saints. Journey with me through Luke. Find Jesus and walk with him and learn from him and listen to him and obey him and be enamored with him and love him back. Because the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. And that's all I got to say about that. So I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. We're going to, in the future, start looking for ways for us to respond each Sunday. Because I think there's a tangible response that sometimes helps us in these steps. And I think this week, the response is, I guess I'll ask you, is do you see the harvest? And do you, with me, are you willing to take the responsibility of partnering with Christ and looking at this world and going, it needs Jesus. And I don't know whether it's going to be me bringing a meal or speaking up or making a friend with someone that doesn't have a friend or reaching out to someone. But I'm going to look for those people who are open to the peace of Christ. And I'm not going to worry about the people that are just going to, I don't want that Jesus. I'm an atheist. Our religion's stupid. You know, it's okay. Leave them with Christ. But there are people that are hungry. They're hungry like you and I. And they need Christ. They need the body of Christ. And they need you to be what Jesus has called you to be. No more skating on the line. No more minimum requirements. We're all in. We're all in. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you that I'm learning what it means to be a disciple. And thank you for opening my eyes to the harvest field and learning a little bit about what it means. And so, Father, as we look out, we pray for Sir Sanford Fleming College. We pray for the thousands of students that come. They come from all over the world. And they're lonely. And they're poor. And they're looking for God in all the wrong places. I pray we would be a light to them. And we would bring the peace of God, the healing of God, the message of the kingdom of God to them. I pray for the staff and faculty. Often people that struggle through day to day, and maybe they make a lot of money, but the money doesn't really scratch the itch of the soul that so deeply needs them. We pray for this community and all the issues it has, the homelessness, the drug addiction, the politics, the arguing. And we ask as we bring the light of Jesus' message, the hope to the harvest, that each of us, as we go about, will be little lights and salt. And that these little miracles we have, the prayer we have for a coworker, the message of hope for someone that needs it, the invitation to church for someone that doesn't have a family, we would look at all that and go, pick me, God. I'll join you. I'll be a worker in your harvest field. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't you stand? In Acts chapter 9, or Acts chapter 8, a great persecution broke out on the early church, and they were all clustered together in Jerusalem. And what happened is, because of the persecution, disciples spread throughout the whole region. And the funny thing is, the apostles, is what Jesus called them, means sent ones, stayed in Jerusalem, and everybody else went out. But here's the thing, everywhere they went, churches erupted. People started coming together. There was beautiful stuff happening. Eventually, the disciples had to leave the comforts of home to go and support them. I gotta think that some of those people that went out and shared Jesus were some of those 72 who got it. Isn't that cool? Years later, him sending them out with a simple message. And then a need happened in the whole region. And before long, Jesus broke out everywhere. That was pretty cool. Pretty cool. So why don't you sing with us?
On nothing less than Jesus.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest thing, but only trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. And through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the rail. My anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, the cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. And
I didn't take any questions. Does anybody have a question or comment about today's message? Something you want to ask or clarify? I think this is good, because if I get up and say something really stupid, it'd be nice if someone can, you know, challenge me on it, right? Just keep me honest. And so, as we talk about today's message, any questions or comments? There's a big ask today, so if you want clarification, now's your chance. Anyone? Yes, Tammy.
I think one of the things that jumped out at me too is when he said he sent them ahead of him.
Yes.
And it's he tells us that we're to share and to spread the good news.
Yeah.
But I think we get caught up in, it didn't go anywhere. You know, the closing of the deal, so to speak.
Yeah.
And that there's a comfort in the fact that he sent them out before he came.
Yeah.
So it's our job to do the certain things he calls us to do.
Yes.
But then he's coming after.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
To work in the hearts of, that we don't know what he's going to do.
Yeah.
But he does the closing of the deal.
Absolutely.
And to realize that.
Yeah.
And that it's not on us. he's out there to finish.
I could do a whole week on that, eh? Like, you know, I just think of the people, like, it's a miracle anybody comes to Jesus. It really is. Because, you know, like, you think about all the things that people, you know, end up navigating to get to Jesus, right? Like my father, like when he became a follower of Christ, like what a miracle that was. Like I believe anybody can become a Christian after my father came to Christ. But it was like the planets aligned that a guy who was 3 weeks on the road, 1 week at home, shacked up with a girlfriend who lived in the next town over, the pastor passed probably 200 churches, was a pastor, one of the pastors in my church, went there on that specific night, responding to a response card by the girlfriend who had been at church and not my father, and the two of them met, and that night, by 3 o'clock in the morning, my father had given everything to Jesus and was filled with the Holy Spirit. That's not normal, right? And many of you have had the same story. You know, it really is. We go ahead of Christ. We do our part, but it's going to be a wave of the miraculous that's going to bring people to Jesus. We do our part, but he's the one that is coming after us. Good. That is a great point, Tammy. Anybody else? Sorry, I get the gift of the gab today. Oh, Krista, yeah. I can't hear you. Oh, there you are. Okay.
Turn my monitor back on so I can hear what I'm saying. Sometimes we don't, and Tammy, I'm just responding and building on what you're saying. We don't always know the end result of what God's plan is, and we don't always see the bigger picture. And sometimes it's something really big, and sometimes it's something really small. And I've mentioned this story before, but there was a season in my life that I was going through that was really difficult. And this is telling. I can't even tell you what the season, what was troubling me at the time. I just know that God had asked me to make a choice that was a difficult choice. It was the right choice, but it was causing me a lot of discomfort and pain and struggle. But I knew I was doing the right thing, but it was hard. And I was just going through it. It wasn't something that was publicly known. It wasn't, nobody else knew. I was having a hard time. And there was a lady in our church, and she used to put together gift baskets to be handed out to people that were in need. And so they would kind of let her know how many they needed, and she would put them together and bring them into the church, and then they would pass them along. That was her ministry. Anyways, she had put a few of them together because she knew how many she needed. And God tapped her on the shoulder and said, "You need to make one more." And so she's like, well, I don't know where I was supposed to go or why. But anyway, she did what God asked her to do. It was just something for her that was simple, something that was for her that was regular, something that she always did. And just this little voice from God saying, make one more. And so she did. And she brought them all in, including the extra one, and gave them to the secretary at the church and explained to her and said, I know you asked for this many, but God said that I was supposed to make one more. I don't know who it's for. I don't know what the purpose is. I just know that that's what he asked me to do. So that's what I did. And she left. The secretary at the church was one of the very few people that knew. She didn't know all the details, but she knew I was going through a difficult time. She fairly ran down to my office and plunked this basket on my desk. And she said to me, I just know that God means for you to have this right now. And then she gave me a hug and she left. And I sat down at my desk and I wept. Because in that moment, God spoke to my heart and said, I know you know that what you're doing is the right thing. And I know this is hard for you, but I want you to know that I see you. and I see what the struggle is, and I care, and I want you to know that I love you. And so here's, I don't remember what the issue is, but never will I forget the day that God sent me a gift, a fruit basket, because he touched my heart and said, I see you. And she didn't, the lady that put them together, you know, doesn't know the whole story. She was just doing her little part. She was responding to the voice of God saying, I don't know why, I don't know who this is for, I don't know what the big deal is, but okay, I'm gonna put another basket together. So I think sometimes we as you say, Tammy, we just do our little part. We go ahead, we respond to God's leading, and we do what God has asked us to do. But we don't always realize what God is doing, and that's the greater part. We offer what we have, and it may be small, but boy, oh boy, that fruit basket was so much more than a fruit basket when I got it.
It was
my God speaking to me, and an avenue for him to communicate his love to me, and it came from a fruit basket that somebody put together.
That's cool.
So if that's encouraging anybody that's hearing God's voice to say something, step out, don't hesitate. You never will know the impact that we'll have on those around you and how God's going to use you. We do this much and he does this much.
It's amazing. Anybody else? How many people in the world are going around wanting someone to see them, right? You look across social media and you see people out there, does anybody see me? It's not us that they need to see them. It's Jesus, right? It's the day you knock and something knocks back. Well, God bless you. Thanks for being with us. Part 2 of the 72. I got more to say about this passage. Comes next week as we continue in the Jesus encounters. God bless you as you go. Don't leave here without knowing that you are going out to a harvest field. You're not going out to work. You're not going out to, you know, family, all those kind of things. That all happens. But you are called to a higher purpose. And at Kawartha Community Church, we are going to impact this college and this city and this world, because we are going to carry the message of God's peace, healing, and the kingdom of God. Amen. See you next week.